Thank you so much, John. Now I invite you to turn in your Bible. I hope that wherever you are, you'll have the Word of God open in front of you and turn to Jeremiah chapter 29. Jeremiah chapter 29. Last Sunday, we began looking at this well-known and much-loved promise in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. We mentioned last week that this is heaven's promise for turbulent times. Here we have scripture that gives us perspective in pandemic. That's provided we understand it correctly. And that's why we set out last week to put this verse in its context, because any verse taken out of context can be misused. So just by way of review from last Sunday, we began looking at the context of the promise, and we started off by just noticing the broader context. The wonderful promise is found in the Old Testament book of the prophet Jeremiah. God called Jeremiah to warn his wayward people that unless they repented of their sins of idolatry and immorality and superficial religiosity, that he would judge them and that he would use as his instrument of judgment the wicked and ruthless Babylonians. For 40 years, Jeremiah faithfully issued those warnings from God, and he was ignored. And so in 597 BC, the Babylonian army conquered the city of Jerusalem and the surrounding Judea, and they carried a large portion of the population off to Babylon in exile. They were carted off across 1,000 miles of desert and ended up in Babylon, where everything was strange, where nothing was familiar. But in the providence of God, Jeremiah was spared deportation. He was allowed to live in his own home among his own people and carry on his ministry to the people around him, but also to the exiles that had been taken into Babylon. By way of application, I quoted Eugene Peterson last week. Just a reminder, the exile experienced by the Hebrews is a dramatic instance and illustration of what we all experience simply by being alive in this world. Repeatedly, we find ourselves in circumstances where we're not at home. The essential meaning of exile is that we are where we don't want to be. The essential meaning of exile is that we are where we don't want to be. And since March 2020, we have been in COVID-19 exile, in various stages of pandemic lockdown. We have been where we do not want to be. And of course, there are many other forms of exile too. Many other life circumstances that we find ourselves in that we would rather not be in, where we don't feel at home. So the promise, Jeremiah 29:11, is given to people in exile, people who are where they don't want to be, to the people of God in Babylon and to us as the people of God today. So that's the broader context of the promise. But the immediate context of the promise we discovered last week was a letter that Jeremiah had written to the exiles in Babylon, a letter that he was able to send in a diplomatic mailbag to Babylon and to the exiles there. And so let's read the letter beginning in chapter 29, verse 1. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and the other people that Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Down to verse 4. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They're prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says. Verse 10. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come to me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I've banished you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. So that's the immediate context of the promise. This letter that God guided Jeremiah to write to the exiles in Babylon. It was given by the Lord through the prophet in a letter to the exiles in Babylon. It was given to people. It was written to people who were where they didn't want to be. And that's where we find ourselves today, in this pandemic exile. We are where we do not want to be, and in other forms of exile. So that's the context of the promise, the broader context and the immediate context. The broader context being the book of Jeremiah and all the events that are recorded in it. The immediate context, this letter to the exiles from God through Jeremiah. Now, that's kind of a reminder as to what we looked at last week. Now, let's move on to consider the content of the promise. Let's focus on verse 11, this well-known promise that you know by heart probably. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. And the verse contains three very obvious and important truths. Number one, God has plans for his people. God says, I know the plans I have for you. John Stott said, life may appear haphazard. History has been described as being like the tracks made on white paper by the feet of a drunken fly. But no, life is not random, meaningless, or absurd. God had plans for the exiles, and he has plans for us as well. I've often been encouraged by what Paul said about his own life in Philippians 3:12. He said, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. And so he recognized that Christ had taken hold of him to fulfill a purpose. And his desire was to take hold of that for which Christ had taken hold of him. So God clearly had a plan for Paul's life that he wanted to fulfill. And indeed, that is true of all of us. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul said, for it is by grace that you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. And then this, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared or planned in advance for us to do. So God has plans for his people. That's the first obvious truth in this promise. And then secondly, God knows his plans. God says, I know the plans I have for you. Now, he doesn't necessarily divulge all of his plans to us. And I think we can be thankful for that. But he does divulge some of them to us. Just as parents make plans and have dreams for their children, even before they're born, God has plans for us. In fact, Jeremiah is a case in point. If you go back to the beginning of the book of Jeremiah, to the account of his call, we read this in chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. He says, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. And so God had plans for Jeremiah's life, plans which he made before he was born. And the same is true of us. And then the third truth that is obvious in this wonderful promise is that God's plans are good plans. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. And to grasp the meaning of this, we need to read verses 10 and 11 together. Look at the text. This is what the Lord says, when 70 years are completed for Babylon. See, God had a purpose not only for his people, but also for Babylon. So God works on multi-layers in different ways. When the 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place. For, verse 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Babylonian exiles may have found this hard to believe because 70 years was a long time. But God, part of God's plan for Babylon, for them, was 70 years, and it was a good plan. It was a good plan. Perhaps the New Testament equivalent of Jeremiah 29:11 would be Romans 8:28, where we're assured that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. Another Old Testament equivalent would be in the passage that Naomi read to us earlier from Genesis chapter 50, where Joseph says to his brothers, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to save the lives of many people. Now, if you look at verses 12 to 14, another part of God's good plan and purpose for the exiles is stated here. Now, this follows right on from our favorite verse, Jeremiah 29:11. Then, in exile, then you will call upon me and come to me and pray to me. And I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. And I will be found by you, declares the Lord. You see, so God's good plan for his people included not only their eventual liberation from Babylonian captivity, but also their spiritual renewal and restoration, their coming back to him. That was his plan and purpose. Now, when Jeremiah's letter was read to these exiles in Babylon, a few people rejected the message of the letter out of hand, and the rest of chapter 29 talks about them. But it seems that others, maybe most others, accepted it. Listen to what Eugene Peterson says on this. Jarred out of the everydayness by the exile, they embarked on a search for God. They settled down to find out what it means to be God's people in a place where they do not want to be, in Babylon. The result was that this became the most productive period in the entire sweep of Hebrew history. They did not lose their identity as God's chosen people. They discovered it. They learned how to pray in a deeper and more life-changing way than ever. They wrote and pondered the vast revelation that had come down to them through Moses and the prophets. And they came to recognize the incredible riches of Scripture. They found that God was not dependent on a place. He was not tied to familiar surroundings. The violent dislocation of the exile shook them out of their comfortable but reality-distorting assumptions and allowed them to see depths and heights they had never imagined before. They lost everything they thought was important, and they found what was important. They found God. And so may we. God's promise stands firm. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then, in your exile, in your COVID-19 exile, you will call on me and come to me and pray, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found by you. That's the content of this promise. God has plans for you. God knows his plans for you. And God's plans for you are good plans. Primarily that you might seek him with all your heart and that he might be found by you. Now we've considered the context of the promise and briefly examined its content. I want to conclude with the contemporary application of this promise. How might we apply it today? What is the COVID-19 application of the promise, if you like? It's a glorious promise, and in its context, it challenges us. And I want to just share four takeaways. The first is that this promise challenges us to expect exile. To remind you of what Eugene Peterson wrote, the exile experienced by the Hebrews is a dramatic instance and illustration of what we all experience simply by being alive in this world. Repeatedly, we find ourselves in circumstances where we are not at home. So, folks, expect exile. Don't be surprised if you find yourself today where you'd rather not be. Don't be surprised if you find yourselves in circumstances where you're not at home. Paul, in Acts 14:22, reminded us that we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. Many exiles, many difficulties. So expect exile. And then number two, be faithful in exile. Just look again at what Jeremiah urged those exiles to do, or what God urged them to do through Jeremiah's letter. This is what the Lord Almighty, verse 4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I've carried you into exile. Pray for it to the Lord, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Now, how might these instructions to the exiles in Babylon apply to us in our COVID-19 exile? Or how might they apply in other exile situations that you might find yourself in this morning? Let me pick out a few words or phrases and just kind of press them into your mind and hearts. First of all, in verse 5, the words settle down. In other words, live fully in the present. Make the most of today. Let's face it, you may not make it through the pandemic. I may not. We may become one of the statistics. So we may not have life on the other side, but we have life today. And so settle down. Make the most of today. Don't waste time wishing for tomorrow, wishing for the time when the pandemic is over. Martin Balsham said, "You are given a cup full of time, and you either drink it or spill it on the ground." You're given a cup full of time. You either drink it or spill it on the ground. So settle down. Don't waste this opportunity. Unpack, live today. That's essentially what God was saying to the exiles in Babylon, and that's what he's saying to us. And then verse 6, let me pick out these words. Increase, do not decrease. Make this exile a time of growth, God said to them. A time to go forward. And that's what he says to us. Increase, do not decrease. Don't go backwards. One of the things that I loved about reading our Ferndale lockdown reflections, as many of you shared your stories over last year, again and again in the lockdown reflections, it was obvious that many of you were making the most and were growing in lockdown in a whole ton of ways. Some of you said that your marriages had grown through lockdown and having been able to spend more time together. A number spoke about quality family time that they hadn't enjoyed before and were making the most of. Some learned new skills. I think all of us became a little more technologically savvy, including yours truly. You read more books. You grew in knowledge. Some of you cleaned out your cupboards and your garages and got rid of junk, and that was a good thing. Maybe not increasing. Maybe that was increasing by decreasing. But keep doing this. We don't know how long this current exile, this current lockdown is going to last. But let's make it a time of growth. Let's not end the exile further back or just where we were when we entered it. Increase, do not decrease. And then verse 7, listen to this. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city of Babylon. In other words, help people around you to have a better life. Your family, your neighbors, your fellow believers, people in your neighborhood, the lonely, the poor. We have a friend who lives in Parktown North, and she feeds close to 70 people every day, homeless people. There are hours that she prepares all this food, and people come to her gate, and they are given a meal and one of our little gospel tracts, and that's what she's doing, and she is making life better for that number of people who come to her gate every single day. And there are others helping, I think, with the preparation and the provision of food. And what is she doing? She is seeking the peace and prosperity of the city, and there are ways in which all of us can do that. And then also in verse 7, pray. Pray. Pray for the peace of the city, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. And so during this time, let's pray. Let's pray for our church, for our community, for our city, for our country, and indeed for our world. I hope that you're a person who watches the news and who's aware of what's going on in the world. Thanks, John, for your prayer earlier in which you prayed for the world. It's biblical to watch TV. Jesus said so, provided you pray. Remember, he said watch and pray. So watch TV and then pray. And we've got a week coming up, a massive week in one of the major countries of the world, or the major superpower in the world, America, and we need to be praying. I get very sad when I hear people say, I don't watch the news, it's too depressing. As Christians, we have a responsibility to be aware of what's going on in the world, and we have the privilege of praying. So remember, the only place you have to be human, Eugene Peterson reminds us, is where you are right now. The only place you will ever have to live by faith is in the circumstances that you are provided this very day. This house you live in, this family you find yourself in, this job that you have been given, the weather conditions that prevail at the very moment. So don't sit around wishing for change. Live today. Do the next thing as wholeheartedly as you can. And then a third challenge by way of practical application from this passage is beware of false prophets and false promises. We read it in the text. We highlighted it a bit last week. But guard against people, be they well-meaning friends or preachers or authors or TV prophets, guard against people who promise quick fixes and easy outs to the hurting and the gullible. Don't think that by binding the devil or pleading the blood or having more faith or any of those other meaningless spiritual mantras is going to change everything. Don't waste your time with conspiracy theories, fake news, the crazy idea that by taking the vaccine, you're going to be having the mark of the beast placed upon you, and some sinister thing designed by Bill Gates is going to enter your body and keep you out of the kingdom of God. Keep away from rubbish. There's too much to do and too much to rejoice in to get taken up with fake news. So beware of false promises and false prophets. And then last of all, seek God in exile. The 70-year exile, as we said, was part of God's plan to give the people of Judah a hope and a future. And the judgment that God had inflicted on them by sending them into exile was designed to help them seek God wholeheartedly. And once they turned back to God, he would regather them and send them back to Jerusalem, as he promised. But the larger purpose of the exile was to force Israel back to God. That was the larger purpose of the exile. And what is God's larger purpose in our COVID-19 exile? What is his larger purpose for you? Might it be to force you back to God, to crowd you to Christ? Don't waste the opportunity to seek God in exile. Many of us have known the Lord as our Savior for a long time. Our theology is orthodox. We know our Bibles reasonably well. We have years of involvement in church activities. We give faithfully to the Lord's work. We're decent human beings. Our neighbors would probably say that we're good Christians. But maybe in our hearts, we know that we're just really going through the motions. We're spiritually dry. We lack a sense of the presence and the power of God. He's not real to us. We don't hunger and thirst for him. We don't relentlessly pursue him. If we're honest, we'd have to say that we're bored and barren spiritually, and that our Christian life is bland. And so in his love for us, God sends us into exile, into various forms of exile. He puts us in places where we don't want to be. In order, the passage says, in order that we might seek him. And he says to us, I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then in exile, you will call upon me and come to me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found by you. You see, God longs to be found by you. But for this to happen, you must seek him. A.W. Tozer, in his great book, The Pursuit of God, said this: God waits to be wanted. God waits to be wanted. He says, too bad that with so many of us, he waits so long, so very long in vain. God waits to be wanted. How much do you want him? He wants you to want him. Why? Because he wants to be found by you. And he wants you to discover how amazing and how wonderful and how glorious he is. We conclude by quoting Eugene Peterson yet again. It keeps happening. Exile is the worst that reveals the best. When the superfluous is stripped away, we find the essential. And the essential is God. Normal life is full of distractions and irrelevancies. Then catastrophe, dislocation, exile, illness, accident, job loss, divorce, pandemic, death. The reality of our lives is rearranged without anyone consulting us or waiting for our permission. We are no longer at home. All of us are given days, months, years of exile. What will we do with them? Wish we were somebody else, somewhere else, complain, escape into fantasies, drug ourselves into oblivion? Exile reveals what really matters and frees us to pursue what really matters, which is to seek the Lord our God with all of our hearts. And how do we do that? We do it by praying, by extended times on our knees seeking God. We have access. One of our great privileges as believers is access into the presence of God, access into the Holy of Holies. The veil has been torn in two. We have access through Christ to the Father by the Spirit. That's our privilege. Access. And so we pray, we go into the presence of God, and we open his word with the cry, Lord, show me your glory. And then we see ourselves, and we engage in self-examination and repentance and confession, and we find God, and he finds us. And that's the main purpose of exile. And that's what God is wanting to do in my life and in your life. So don't miss the chance. Exile reveals what really matters and frees us to pursue what really matters, which is to seek the Lord with all our hearts. So I want to encourage you, I want to urge you, as I do myself, to do that. My friend Bruce Dennell wrote a song which he sang when I preached on this passage some years ago, and we're going to be ministered to as we listen to Bruce. Thank you, Bruce, for the gift of this song, and let's listen, and then I'm going to pray for us.
Undecided at the outset, I've forgotten how to rhyme. Sit for hours trying to create an image of the time we've spent away from you, pretending to be free, while your dreams for us were frustrated, as we refused to see that the plans you have for us are made to prosper. You would never for a moment cause us harm, and you promised you would call us back from exile if we would only seek your open arms. Taken far from our own context, we've tried to find our place, hold on tight to our convictions, with no thought for the race you've taught for us to run, that leads us back to you. So sure of where we thought we'd go, what we thought we knew, but the plans you have for us are made to prosper. You would never for a moment cause us harm, and you've promised you would call us back from exile. We would only seek your open arms. Can I try again tomorrow? Can I overcome my fear? If I turn with this behind me, what's ahead will soon appear. And the plans you have for us are made to prosper. You would never for a moment cause us harm, and you've promised you would call us back from exile if we would only seek your open arms. Yes, the plans you have for us are made to prosper. You would never for a moment cause us harm, and you promised you would call us back, exile. We would only seek your open arms.
Will you join me as we pray together? God, our Father, thank you for the gift of this wonderful promise. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. And Lord, as we find ourselves at this time in the history of the world and in the history of our own country, in a time of COVID-19 exile, we find ourselves where we would rather not be, with the hardships and the adjustments. We find ourselves not feeling at home. We pray that in these days and months and however long, that you would help us to seek you with all of our hearts. Thank you that you want to be found by us. You want us to taste and see that you're good. You want us to delight in you and to know that in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And so we pray that you'd give us hearts to seek you, that the confines of the exile would crowd us to Christ and not to despair. And so, Lord, be with us and help us. And may your grace and mercy and peace be with us now and through the rest of this week and the rest of this exile. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.